Welcome. My name is Michael Kelly, and tonight is a special program here on Channel 17. In our series of poets, we've decided to turn away from the contemporary poet and look at more of a classical poet. Tonight's program is called G.K. Chesterton, The Last of the Romantics. My guest tonight is someone near and dear to myself, Raymond J. Kelly Jr., who is my father, but that is the least of his accomplishments. He's a graduate of Notre Dame, general partner with Roney & Company. He served in myriad community posts, including chairman of the Board of Trustees over at Mott College, chairman of the Genesee County Parochial School Board, and more commissions and agencies than we could name here. Most recently, he was named to the Board of Trustees of the International G.K. Chesterton Society, which is an organization honoring the quintessential English poet G.K. Chesterton. What can you tell us about G.K. Chesterton?
Well, G.K. was a poet that I always loved. I first got to read some of his stuff in high school. And 20th century poets tend to be people of harshness. They have no fun. They have no faith. Life is really brutish to a great number of them. As for Chesterton, he's absolutely the opposite. Life is fun. God is real, and belief makes all life richer. And G.K., I want to give a number of sides of G.K. Chesterton, the poet. He was a journalist, he was a dramatic and literary critic, but he was a poet first, last, and always. And I'd like to give the first bit, the rolling English road. Before the Roman came to Rye, or out to Severn strode, the rolling English drunkard made the rolling English road. A reeling road, a rolling road that rambles round the shire, and after him the parson ran, the sexton, and the squire. A merry road, a mazy road, and such as we did tread, the night we went to Birmingham by way of Beachy Head. I knew no harm of Bonaparte, and plenty of the squire, and for to fight the Frenchman I did not much desire. But I did bash their baggonets because they came arrayed to straighten out the crooked road an English drunkard made. Where you and I went down the lane with ale mugs in our hands the night we went to Glastonbury by way of Goodwin Sands. His sins, they were forgiven him. Or why do flowers run behind him and all hedges strengthening in the sun? The wild thing went from left to right and knew not which was which. But the wild rose was above him when they found him in the ditch. God pardon us, nor harden us. We did not see so clear the night we went to Bannockburn by way of Brighton Pier. My friends, we will not go again, or ape an ancient rage, or stretch the folly of our youth to be the shame of age, but walk with clearer eyes and ears this path that wandereth, and see undrugged in evening light the decent inn of death. For there is good news yet to hear, and fine things to be seen, before we go to paradise by way of Kensal Green. Always a lover of his country, even when he was critical of some of its aspects, as in his work, The Elegy in a Country Churchyard. The men that worked for England, they have their graves at home, and the bees and birds of England about the cross can roam. But they that fought for England, following a falling star, alas, alas for England, they have their graves afar. And they that rule in England, in stately conclave met, alas, alas for England, they have no graves as yet. These were written between 50 and 75 years ago. The issues have surprisingly changed very little. Communism, money grubbing, paganism, and the elitism of the self-appointed saviors of the world were all grist for his mill. As in the Song of the Strange Ascetic, which is one of my favorites, "If I had been a heathen, I'd have praised the purple vine. My slaves would dig the vineyards, and I would drink the wine." But Higgins is a heathen, and his slaves grow lean and gray, that he may drink some tepid milk exactly twice a day. "If I had been a heathen, I'd have crowned Nayara's curls and filled my life with love affairs, my hosts with dancing girls." But Higgins is a heathen, and to lecture rooms is forced, where his aunts, who are not married, demand to be divorced. "If I had been a heathen, I'd have sent my armies forth and dragged behind my chariots the chieftains of the north." But Higgins is a heathen, and he drives the dreary quill to lend the poor that funny cash that makes them poorer still. "If I had been a heathen, I'd have piled my pyre on high and in a great red whirlwind gone roaring to the sky." But Higgins is a heathen and a richer man than I, and they put him in an oven just as if he were a pie. Now who that runs can read it, the riddle that I write, of why this poor old sinner should sin without delight? But I cannot read it, although I run and run, of those that do not have the faith and will not have the fun. In the same spirit, he wrote a parody on Leigh Hunt's Abu Ben Adam. I would like to read Abu Ben Adam as Leigh Hunt originally wrote it.
This would be an example of humanism at its
best.
That's
right. "Abu Ben Adam, may his tribe increase, awoke one night from a deep dream of peace and saw within the moonlight in his room, making it rich and like a lily in bloom, an angel writing in a book of gold. Exceeding peace had made Ben Adam bold, and to the presence in the room he said, 'What writest thou?' The vision raised its head, and with a look made of all sweet accord, answered, 'The names of those who love the Lord.' 'And is mine one?' said Abu. 'Nay, not so,' replied the angel. Abu spoke more low, but cheerily still, and said, 'I pray thee then, write me as one that loves his fellow men.' The angel wrote and vanished. The next night it came again with a great awakening light and showed the names whom love of God had blessed. And lo, Ben Adam's name led all the rest." Now, Gilbert Chesterton's response to this poem was "The Philanthropist," and with the subtitle, "With Apologies to a Beautiful Poem." "Abu Ben Adam, may his tribe decrease by cautious birth control and die in peace. Mellow with learning, lightly took the word that marked him not with them that love the Lord. And told the angel of the book and pen, 'Write me as one that loves his fellow men. For them alone I labor, to reclaim the ragged roaming Bedouin, and to tame to ordered service. To uproot their vine who mock the prophet being mad with wine. Let daylight through their tents and through their lives. Number their camels, even count their wives. Plot out the desert into streets and squares, and count it a far more fruitful work than theirs, who lift a vain and visionary love to your vague Allah in the skies above. Gently replied the angel of the pen, labor in peace and love your fellow men, and love not God, since men alone are dear. Only fear God, for you have cause to fear. In the field of poetry, Chesterton's tour de force was entitled Lepanto, his dramatic story of the naval battle in 1571, where the papal, Genoese, Venetian, and Spanish fleets defeated the Turks, who were bent on the conquest of Europe. This is Lepanto. White fonts falling in the courts of the sun, and the soldan of Byzantium is smiling as they run. There is laughter like the fountain in that face of all men feared. It stirs the forest darkness, the darkness of his beard. It curls the blood-red crescent, the crescent of his lips, for the inmost sea of all the earth is shaken with his ships. They have dared the white republics up the capes of Italy. They have dashed the Adriatic round the lion of the sea. And the Pope has cast his arms abroad for agony and loss, and called the kings of Christendom for swords about the cross. The cold Queen of England is looking in the glass. The shadow of the Valois is yawning at the mass. From Evening Isle's fantasticals rings faint the Spanish gun, and the Lord upon the golden horn is laughing in the sun. Dim drums throbbing in the hills half heard, where only on a nameless throne a crownless prince has stirred. Where risen from a doubtful seat and half a tainted stall, the last knight of Europe takes weapons from the wall. The last and lingering troubadour to whom the bird has sung, that once went winging southward when all the world was young. In that enormous silence, tiny and unafraid, comes up along a winding road the noise of the crusade. Strong gongs groaning as the guns boom far. Don John of Austria is going to the war. Stiff flags straining in the night blast cold, in the gloom black purple and the glint old gold. Torchlight crimson on the copper kettle drums, then the tuckets, then the trumpets, then the cannon, and he comes. Don John laughing in that brave beard curled, spurning of his stirrups like the thrones of all the world, holding his head up for a flag of all the free. Love light of Spain, hurrah! Death light of Africa! Don John of Austria is riding to the sea. My hound is in his paradise above the evening star. Don John of Austria is going to the war. He moves that mighty turban on the timeless houri's knees, his turban that is woven of the sunset and the seas. He shakes the peacock gardens as he rises from his ease, and he strides among the treetops and is taller than the trees. And his voice through all the garden is a thunder sent to bring black Azrael and Ariel and Amun on the wing. Giants and the genii, multiplex wing and eye, whose strong obedience broke the sky when Solomon was king. They rush in red and purple from the red clouds of the north, from temples where the yellow gods shut up their eyes in scorn. They rise in green robes roaring from the green hells of the sea, where fallen skies and evil hues and eyeless creatures be. And then the sea valves cluster, and the gray sea forests curl, splashed with a splendid sickness, the sickness of the pearl. They swell in sapphire smoke out of the blue cracks of the ground, They gather and they wonder and give worship to Mahound. And he saith, break up the mountains where the hermit folk may hide, and sift the red and silver sands, lest bone of saint abide, and chase the gowers flying night and day, not giving rest. For that which was our trouble comes again out of the west. We have set the seal of Solomon on all things under sun, of knowledge and of sorrow and endurance of things done. But a noise is in the mountains. In the mountains, and I know that voice that shook our palaces 400 years ago. It is he that saith not Kismet. It is he that knows not fate. It is Richard. It is Raymond. It is Godfrey in the gate. It is he whose loss is laughter when he counts the wager worth. Put down your feet upon him that are peace beyond the earth. For he heard drums groaning and he heard guns jar. Don Juan of Austria is going to the war. Sudden and still hurrah, bolt from Iberia. Don John of Austria is gone by Alcalar. St. Michael's on his mountain in the sea roads of the north. Don John of Austria is girt and going forth. Where the gray seas glitter and the sharp tides shift, and the sea folk labor and the red sails lift, he shakes his lance of iron and he claps his wings of stone. The noise is gone through Normandy. The noise is gone alone. The north is full of tangled things and texts and aching eyes, and dead is all the innocence of anger and surprise. And Christian killeth Christian in a narrow, dusty room, and Christian dreadeth Christ that hath a newer face of doom. And Christian hateth Mary that God kissed in Galilee. But Don John of Austria is riding to the sea. Don John calling through the blast and the eclipse, crying with the trumpet of his lips. Trumpet that say, ha, Domino Gloria. Don John of Austria is shouting to the ships. King Philip's in his closet with the fleece about his neck. Don John of Austria is armed upon the deck. The walls are hung with velvet that is black and soft as sin, and little dwarfs creep out of it and little dwarfs creep in. He holds a silver vial that has colors like the moon. He touches and it tingles and he trembles very soon, and his face is as a fungus of a leprous white and gray, like plants in the high houses that are shuttered from the day. And death is in the file, and the end of noble work. But Don John of Austria has fired upon the Turk. Don John's hunting, and his hounds have bayed. Booms away past Italy the rumor of his raid. Gun upon gun, ha-ha! Gun upon gun, hurrah! Don John of Austria has loosed the cannonade. The Pope was in his chapel before day or battle broke. Don John of Austria is hidden in the smoke. The hidden room in a man's house where God sits all the year, the secret window whence the world looks small and very dear. He sees as in a mirror on the monstrous twilight sea the crescent of his cruel ships, whose name is mystery. They fling great shadows forward, making cross and castles dark. They veil the plumed lions on the galleys of St. Mark. And above the ships are palaces of brown, black-bearded chiefs. And below the ships are prisons, where with multitudinous griefs, Christian captives, sick and sunless, all laboring race repines, like a race in sunken cities, like a nation in the mines. They are lost like slaves that swat, and in the skies of morning hung the stairways of the tallest gods when tyranny was young. They are countless, voiceless, hopeless, as those fallen or fleeing on before the high king's horses in the granite of Babylon. And many a one grows witless in his quiet room in hell, where a yellow face looks inward through the lattice of his cell. And he finds his God forgotten, and he seeks no more a sign. But Don John of Austria has burst the battle line. Don John pounding from the slaughter-painted poop, purpling all the oceans like a bloody pirate sloop. Scarlets running over on the silvers and the golds, breaking of the hatches up and bursting of the holds. Thronging of the thousands up that labor under sea, white for bliss and blind for sun and stunned for liberty. Viva Hispania Domino Gloria, Don John of Austria has set his people free. Cervantes and his galley sets the sword back in the sheath. Don John of Austria rides homeward with a wreath. And he sees along a weary land a straggling road in Spain, up which a lean and foolish knight forever rides in vain. And he smiles, but not his sultan's smile, and settles back the blade. But Don John of Austria rides home from the crusade. But his topics, Chesterton's that is, don't have to be vast or of great import, as witness this little one entitled The Donkey. When fishes flew and forests walked, and figs grew upon thorn, some moment when the moon was blood, then surely I was born. With monstrous head and sickening cry and ears like errant wings, the devil's walking parody of all four-footed things. The tattered outlaw of the earth, of ancient crooked will, starve, scourge, deride me, I am dumb. I keep my secret still. Fools, for I also had my hour, one far fierce hour and sweet. There was a shout about my ears and palms before my feet.
Ooh. You know what strikes me about much of this work is that it assumes a common legacy, a common body of legend and history.
It does. You had to know the history of Europe. Incidentally, there is one of his poems, Me Heart, which I love because it does have a certain Celtic flavor to it. I come from Castle Patrick, and my heart is on my sleeve, and any sword or pistol boy can hit it with me leave. It shines there for an epaulet, as golden as a flame, and as naked as me ancestors, as noble as my name. For I come from Castle Patrick, and my heart is on my sleeve, but a lady stole it from me on St. Galloglass's Eve. The folk that live in Liverpool, their heart is in their boots. They go to hell like lambs they do, because the hooter hoots. Where men may not be dancing, though the wheels may dance all day, and men may not be smoking, but only chimneys may. But I come from Castle Patrick, and my heart is on my sleeve, but a lady stole it from me on St. Polyander's Eve. The folk that live in Black Belfast, their heart is in their mouth. They set us making murders in the meadows of the south. They think a plow's a rack they do, and cattle calls are creeds. And they think we're burning witches when we're only burning weeds. But I come from Castle Patrick, and my heart is on my sleeve. But a lady stole it from me on St. Barnabas's Eve.
Well, we're nearing the end of the program. You have a place to finish with G.K. Chesterton.
Well, I'll tell you, I would like to just bring one little bit here. In the early 30s, G.K. spent a semester as an artist in residence at the University of Notre Dame in South Bend.
Place where both of us graduated, I'll admit.
And he saw his first game.
his football game.
And from that experience, drew a comparison between ancient Rome with its Colosseum and the Golden Dome of the university, surmounted by the statue of the Virgin, looking down on the stadium where they were. There was a football game. I'd like to just run through it. It just takes a couple of minutes. There uprose the golden giant in the gilded house of Nero, even his far-flung flaming shadow and his image swollen large, looking down in the dry whirlpool of the round arena spinning, as the chariot wheel goes spinning, and the chariots at the charge. Saw the molten monstrous visage, saw the pageant, saw the torments. Down the golden dust undazzled saw the gladiators go. Heard the cry in the closed desert, te salutant morituri, as the slaves of doom went stumbling, shuddering to the shades below. Lord of life, of liars and laughter, those about to die salute thee at thy godlike fancy, feeding men with bread and beasts with men. But for us, the fates point deathward, in a thousand thumbs thrust downward, and the dog of hell is roaring through the lions and the dead. I have seen where a strange country opened its secret plains about me. One great golden dome stands lonely with its golden image one. Seen afar in strange fulfillment through the sunlit Indian summer, that apocalyptic portent that has clothed her with the sun. She too looks upon the arena, sees the gladiators in grapple, she whose names are seven sorrows and the cause of all our joy, sees that pit that stank with slaughter, scoured to make the courts of mourning for the cheers of jesting kindred and the scampering of a boy. Queen of death and deadly weeping, those about to live salute thee, youth untroubled, youth untortured, hateless war and harmless mirth, and the new lord's larger, largest, holier bread and happier circus, since the queen of sevenfold sorrow has brought joy upon the earth, burns above the broad arena where the swirling centuries circle, burns the suncloth on the summit, golden sheeted, golden shod, like a sunburst on the mountains, like the flames upon the forest of the sunbeams, of the sword blades, of the gladiators of God. And I saw them shock the whirlwind of a world of dust and dazzle, and thrice they stamped a thunderclap, and thrice the sand wheels swirled, and thrice they cried like thunder on Our Lady of the Victories, the mother of the master, of the masters of the world. Queen of death, and life undying, those about to live salute thee, not the crawlers with the cattle looking deathward with the swine, but the shout upon the mountain of the men that live forever, who are free of all things living, but a child, and he was thine.
G.K. Chesterton, the last of the Romantics, a somewhat different poetic voice than we're used to hearing these days, but a very rich one that deserves being heard. Raymond J. Kelly Jr. was our guest tonight. My name is Michael Kelly. Thank you for having joined us here on Channel 17.